I think we'll start. Welcome everyone very much to this session that's part of the British Art and Natural Forces, a State of the Field research program that here at the PMC we've been running right through this autumn and into the winter. My name is Mark Hallett. I'm the Director of Studies at the Paul Mellon Centre, and I'm really pleased to be chairing and hosting this Zoom webinar. As you know, it's called Curating the Siege, and it's with a subtitle that's a really interesting one of Oceanic Exhibition Making at a Time of Ecological Crisis. I'll just say a word or two about the programme that this particular session is part of. This year, we at the PMC are celebrating our 50th anniversary, and we're an institution dedicated to the study of British art and architecture. We've been doing that for, as I said, 50 years now. But this year, of course, it's been a year in which artistic practice and the practice of artistry itself have met with the unprecedented force of a global pandemic. And so this really made us and forced us to think afresh about our programme for this autumn. And this multi-part programme does indeed focus on the encounter between artistic and art historical practice on the one hand, and the force of the natural world. And it places such encounters in both contemporary and historical perspectives. If you've not had a chance already to engage with the events that have taken place, and there have been a number of them now, as part of this programme, please visit our website. We have recordings of the events that have taken place already, and they're packed with really fascinating talks and discussions. But this is a special event today, because it not only offers a chance for us to engage with a really interesting panel discussion, but it also marks the publication of a special issue of the Journal of Curatorial Studies on the topic of Curating the Sea, Oceanic Exhibition Making at a Time of Ecological Crisis. And as has been said in the introduction to this talk, on our website, the past decade has witnessed a proliferation of ocean-themed exhibitions. And these exhibitions have developed from oceanic in theme to exploring oceanic curatorial methods in themselves. And so on the occasion of this special publication of Journal of Curatorial Studies, this panel will offer perspectives on recent examples of and future directions for what we might call the exhibitionary oceanic, which is a lovely phrase. We've got some wonderful speakers for you. And this is how the format of the event will take place. We've got an hour and a half, and we'll be hearing, we've got plenty of time for discussion, but I'll just introduce very quickly the fact that we've got four speakers, and then we'll have a chance for discussion at the end of the session. But before I introduce the speakers individually, I just wanted to go through the housekeeping that's now, of course, part of such Zoom events. So all of you will be automatically muted when you join the webinar and can only communicate verbally if the host unmutes you. Each of the talks, and we've got three talks, one of which is a joint talk, will last 15 minutes. And we've scheduled plenty of time for discussion after the three talks when we'll invite you to ask questions. So please use the Q&A box to ask or write your questions, and then we can pass those on to the speakers. You can also make use of the virtual raise hand button if you have a question or a comment that you'd like to make verbally rather than in written form. And you can use the chat box to make comments to let us know if you're experiencing technical difficulties. The session will be recorded, but no photographs should be taken, please. And of course, it goes without saying that any offensive behavior will not be tolerated, and attendees can be removed from the webinar by the host. So that's really the housekeeping that I wanted to mention to you. Now we can focus down on the papers and the panel itself. So we're gonna have three papers, and what we're gonna do, we decided to do, is to run them one after the other and then open up the floor, as it were, to questions afterwards. Our first talk will be by Sarah Wade, who's a lecturer in museum studies at the University of East Anglia, and Pandora Syperek, who's a research associate at Loughborough University. And their talk will be entitled Curating the Sea, Oceanic Exhibition Making at a Time of Ecological Crisis. So they very much focus on this particular topic. And then following Sarah and Pandora's paper, we'll have a paper from Stefanie Hessler, who's director of the Kunsthall Trondheim, with another wonderful title, Tidalectic Curating. I think all of us are very excited by that thought of what that precisely that term and its possibilities. And then finally, Miranda Lowe, who's the principal curator at the Natural History Museum, will be giving her talk, which is called Through the Curatorial Looking Glass. So I think I'll begin right away. We haven't got much time in terms of introduction, so I'm being very, very brief, but that gives us more time to listen to the speakers. So can I turn over now to Sarah and to Pandora?
Thanks, Mark. So, thanks so much for joining us for the launch of our special issue of the Journal of Curatorial Studies on Curating the Sea, guest edited by myself and Pandora. And thanks to you for the Paul Mellon Centre for hosting us, especially Mark, Anna, Ella and Danny for hosting us today and for their careful planning of this event. We're really pleased to be included in this rich and important programme. So through our presentation today, we're going to give you a bit of the background to the project and introduce some of the conclusions we drew from developing the special issue. And we'll also talk about the shifting concerns and future directions of the Oceanic Anthropocene in exhibition making. And I should just say that we're really grateful to Stefanie and Miranda for joining us today, two collaborators on this project. Stefanie has an article in the special issue, and Miranda worked with us with another curator at the Natural History Museum, Richard Sabin, on an in-conversation piece that was published in the Science Museum Group Journal last year. So we hope that by including Stefanie and Miranda in the discussions today, that we'll be able to explore curatorial practice from different institutional perspectives and really consider the crossovers of art and science that this project made apparent are so integral to Curating the Sea. Our project started in 2017 in recognition of the wave of ocean-themed exhibitions that had emerged in international and interdisciplinary contexts. This was the year that the Natural History Museum in London replaced their famous and much-loved central hall specimen, Dippy the Diplodocus, with Hope the Blue Whale, signalling a new paradigm of scientific display that placed an anthropogenic extinction narrative centre stage in a world-renowned museum. And you can see from this image that Hope has already become an iconic reference point for this subject, with Extinction Rebellion enacting a die-in beneath the specimen in 2019. Ocean ecology was figuring in exhibitions of contemporary art at this time as well. The same year that Hope was installed, the exhibition Offshore, Artists Explore the Sea, opened in the port city of Hull as it celebrated its turn as UK City of Culture. The show presented historical and contemporary art alongside oceanic visual and material culture in the dual sites of Ferns Art Gallery and Hull Maritime Museum, an interdisciplinary method that was furthered through the curatorial collective Invisible Dusts commissions of artworks produced in collaboration with scientists. For example, for Kaja Mulga's coral love story, Getting Acquainted, the artist worked with the company Electronudes and in consultation with marine scientists to create a wearable which scans the data produced by the Great Barrier Reef marine stations and translates the experiences of coral under threat from climate change into sensations palpable to a dancer's body. The transhistorical and transdisciplinary approach to curating the sea in Offshore was precedented by Aquatopia, the imaginary of the ocean deep, which travelled between Nottingham Contemporary and Tate St Ives across 2013-2014. This large group show brought together a diverse assemblage of objects, juxtaposing scientific models and illustrations, scrimshaw, Japanese woodcut prints, historical maritime paintings, and contemporary art to explore the wonder of the sea in natural and cultural history in an exhibition that traversed disciplines, eras, and geographies. Numerous exhibitions since have explored more thematically specific and ecologically explicit narratives of the sea. In 2018, we organised the symposium Curating the Sea, Ecological Vulnerability and the Oceans in Contemporary Exhibitions to explore this turn to the sea in recent exhibition making. We were driven by the conviction that curatorial practice could offer a unique perspective on the current ecological state of the oceans and that visual and material culture could make an important contribution to the blue humanities. It was already clear to us that interdisciplinarity and transhistorical approaches to exhibition making were key aspects of curating the sea, but we wanted to consider in more depth exactly why. The special issue of the Journal of Curatorial Studies developed out of this original symposium, and it contains five essays which offer reflections on different approaches to curating the sea. Selena Jeffrey examines her multi-sited exhibition project, Ephemeral Coast, which began in 2015 and focuses on the political and ecological sensitivities of the littoral zone through localized, collaborative, and situated curatorial research that responds to the changing shoreline in the wake of colonization and climate crisis. Following the exhibition, Coral's Something Rich and Strange, which she curated at Manchester Museum in 2013-2014, Marion N. Jones considers the recent proliferation of exhibitions about coral, arguing that curatorial methods heightening visitors' sense of effect can induce wonder and care towards these far from human life forms, who have relatively recently emerged as new flagship species to raise awareness about ocean ecology. Stefanie Hessler, who we're going to hear from later, discusses an oceanic mode of curating that she developed from the poet Camille Braithwaite's conception of tidalectics, which takes its cue from the natural processes of the sea in a challenge to post-Enlightenment epistemological conventions. And then Pandora and I offer a museological take on curating the sea. Pandora, whose PhD was on the displays at the Natural History Museum at its time of its foundation, returned to examine the new installation of Hope, investigating the historical legacy of the museum's central hall and its spectacular specimens towards making a case for an eco-critical museology. And my own essay considers how exhibitions not only focus on ecological issues, but work in ecological ways at the Oceanographic Museum of Monaco, whose founding premise of housing objects of both art and science was reaffirmed through the inauguration of a contemporary art programme, which I examined through Mark Dion's Wunderkammer installation Oceaniomania, which is the front cover image of the special issue, and the shark exhibition programme that ran at the museum between 2013 and 2015. Collectively, these essays demonstrate that curating, as a spatial and material practice that can mediate between different disciplines, including across the arts and sciences, is uniquely placed to bring various oceanic fragments together from different eras and locations in new and unexpected ways, offering generative ways for thinking through the threats facing the oceans and ocean life now and in the future. The curatorial approaches discussed in this special issue offer ways to diversify the monolithic Anthropocene ocean by embracing multiple perspectives and adopting methodologies that deviate from dominant Western models of representation and epistemology, providing alternatives to so-called rational taxonomies and linear exhibition narratives by using methods that are process-based, site-specific, or in flux, and by placing importance on modes of knowledge which might be embodied or effective. These articles and the case studies they explore show that curating the sea harbours fluid exhibition possibilities that are necessarily transdisciplinary, transhistorical, transgeographical, and even transspecies, facilitating links across temporalities, geographies, and life forms in ways that can foster an ethics of care by highlighting interconnections and the shared significance of the ecological importance of the sea. So I'm going to hand over to Pandora now.
Hey, thank you, Sarah. Hi, everyone. I'm going to give a reflection now on the increasingly sophisticated understandings of ocean ecology within recent exhibitions, including attention to more alien life forms and their symbiotic relationships, sometimes amounting to sort of queering the sea, the integration of decolonial and critical race theory, and increasingly experimental modes of curatorial activity responding to these issues. So let me just share with you now. Okay, so throughout the project, Sarah and I have been aware of the intersections within broader popular culture, as well as within academia. For example, many of these exhibitions coincided with the filming of Blue Planet 2, which the Natural History Museum curators suggested was on their radar when the new Central Hall was being planned. If our project launched in light of the so-called Blue Planet effect, it wraps up in the age of my octopus teacher. While Blue Planet 2 was explicit about the impact of climate change and ocean plastics, this recent Netflix film delves into human-animal relations, significantly focusing on one of the sea's more alien creatures. And the philosopher Sophie Lewis tweeted an excellent critique of the erotics of the human octopus encounter and its intrinsic queerness. Investigations by other feminist posthumous theorists such as Karen Barad and Hayward probe the queer ecologies of such radically other, more than human life worlds. Increasingly, contemporary art and exhibitions have responded to this call to consider the non-human otherness of the sea and its interspecies encounters. And in the special issue, both Marionette Jones' text on coral and my own on alternatives to the blue whale explore the ecological potential of less charismatic or anthropomorphic species and their symbioses. In exhibitions, this has at times involved turning to historical artifacts, such as the Blaschka glass models of marine invertebrates, which held in museum storage for more than a century, have recently resurfaced in exhibitions of both contemporary art, such as Aquatopia, and natural history alike. And I think Miranda might be speaking more on these. A similar revival has taken place with the films of Jean Painlevé, and both signal the queer sea creature predecessors in Victorian and Surrealist visual culture. More recently, in Weather Report Forecasting Future in the Nordic Pavilion at last year's Venice Biennale, artists explored interweaving microscopic, bacterial, botanical, and human agencies as in Ingela Ehrman's A Great Seaweed Day. More and more in exhibitions and surrounding discourse, it is evident that it is impossible to separate the entangled realities of social inequality from ecological breakdown. Also at in Venice last year, the Golden Lion winning Lithuanian Pavilion exhibited the privilege behind oceanic devastation with its slothful holidaymakers on an artificial beach who came to perform an opera about climate change and ocean pollution. And ironically, before the Biennale was over, Venice was flooded due in large part to climate change. And on the flip side, the 2018 exhibition Oceania at the Royal Academy paid little attention to the effects of climate change on Pacific Islanders, instead focusing on colonialism's other legacies with a much criticized tone of apologism, and ignoring the extractive paradigm's continued damage to these communities. And this is despite the first work encountered within the exhibition being a contemporary artwork by the Mata'aho collective titled Kiko Moana, which envisions the mythological creature Tanifa if it had to combat poor water quality. As the Métis marine scientist Max Libron's forthcoming book title suggests, pollution is colonialism. Erica Balsam's 2018 Blind Feeling of Oneness Between the Individual with the Universe explored the Anthropocene ocean as a multivalent signifier. Films in the series included focused on migration, ocean heating, shipping, industrialized fishing, and in the Autolith Group's 2010 film Hydra Decapita, The Black Atlantis, a mythical underwater land populated by the descendants of pregnant women thrown overboard during the Middle Passage. Kara Walker's 2019 commission for Tate Modern's Turbine Hall, Fons Americanus, formed a monument to the African diaspora and its roots in the transatlantic slave trade. Though Morgan Quaintance has criticized museums as virtue signaling with such works, whilst ignoring the ongoing contemporary realities of systemic racism. Slowly, the colonial and racial politics underlying natural history collections are similarly being examined within these institutions. And this is why we're very happy to have Miranda Lowe here today, who is a founding member of the BAME Museum and Heritage Workers Network Museum Detox, offers Black history tours on the Natural History Museum, and in 2018 co-authored an important article in its historical foundations. Interventions within these collections are often generatively realized through collaboration with artists such as the Museum for Natur Kunst program Art Nature, which included a project by Elizabeth Price responding to the archival history curated by Birgit Ahrens, who spoke in our original Curating the Sea symposium and also in a panel as part of the Natural Forces program last week. Meanwhile, the dismantling of traditional curatorial methods moved towards multi-platform models, mobilizing a response to some of these issues. So for example, TBA 21 Academies programs, in which Stefanie Hessler, who's with us today, played an important role as curator, explore the Anthropocene ocean through expeditions, fellowships, and wide-ranging forms of exhibition based on the principle of collaboration between artists, scientists, and other thinkers. Recently, the collaboration with Institut Kunst, headed by Shuz Martinez, offers an online platform featuring podcasts, texts, and films on intersections of art and ocean ecology during the pandemic. So as the zoonotic coronavirus makes clear both the ramifications of the unsustainable exploitation of wildlife and the need for alternative methods of engagement, an expanded curatorial practice moving towards greater accessibility and channels of discourse becomes ever more necessary. And these, along with the contributions to the special issue, connect to the sea, not only in theme, but also in form, as they echo philosopher Astrida Neimanis' sentiment that water is not only fluid, but also ruptures, leaks, and seethes. Thank you. So,
Mark, you're mute to say.
Thanks very much indeed, Pandora and Sarah, for a really great start to our discussion. I think we'll turn over straight away to Stefanie, who will be talking on Tidalectic curating, a tiny glimpse of which we had in our first talk. So over to you, Stefanie.
Thank you, Mark, and thank you, Sarah and Pandora, for organizing this. And I'm really excited to be here with everyone today. Looking forward also to hearing Miranda speak in a little moment. I'm going to share my screen. All right. The ocean is always outside until it floods your home or exhibition space. The current climate catastrophe does not halt at any boundaries established during the Holocene and promoted in Western modernity. Temperatures do not stay relatively stable. Sea levels rise and overflow countless demarcations of land, while other areas perish in drought. As land dwellers' feet get wet, sparing neither Kiribati nor Miami nor Venice, turmoiled nature cultures, as Donna Haraway calls the entangled and inseparable synthesis of nature and culture, muddle any attempts at expelling nature as a supposed outside which can simply be shut out and its effects ignored. As the realization that an outside which can simply be shut out and its, as a, no, sorry, as the realization that an outside does not exist also seeps into the global north, attempts at separating humanity from nature are becoming ever more futile. Those who can afford it segregate themselves as usual, while others literally have to flee for survival. The oceanic Anthropocene or Capitalocene or Stulocene is unevenly distributed, caused by some parts of humanity more than others and affecting some humans and non-humans more than others. Pointedly, the Métis scholar Zoe Todd highlights the necessity to go beyond the current framework of the Anthropocene as it, and I quote Todd here, blunts the distinctions between the people, nations, and collectives who drive the fossil fuel economy and those who do not. The uneven, uncontainable climate crisis obligates curators to rethink ways of working. Exhibition making in times of ecological disaster and with the effects of ongoing colonial capitalism palpable on a planetary scale needs to differ from previous curatorial modes. Curatorial practice is increasingly accessed not only by its ability to create a convincing argument to support artists or to revisit art history, but also by the way that it addresses and responds to the structures in which it is embedded. I'm showing you in the background some slides of exhibitions that I will come to and speak about more in a moment. In my article in the Journal of Curatorial Studies, I write about some examples of exhibitions applying critical attention to the system in which they operate. For instance, the curator Okwe Inwezo's postcolonialist Documenta 11 in 2002, as well as several directly ocean-related shows such as Koyoko Streamlines at Deichtorhallen in Hamburg in 2015. I also write about Aquatopia and the Ocean After Nature that were briefly mentioned previously. In recent years, more direct forms of activism have emerged in the art world as a reaction to oppressive political contexts and pressing social and environmental issues. Climate activists working in networks such as Culture Declares Emergency have staged protests at institutions like the British Museum in London on the 8th of February 2020 to hold the organization accountable for its carbon emissions, as well as company sponsorship from British Petroleum. Similarly, demands for decolonization by collectives such as Decolonize This Place are putting increasing pressure on institutions, scrutinizing their ethics and fighting for migrant and climate justice. I argue in my article and in a talk today that if tended to diligently, the public and discursive space of exhibitions provides a productive forum to respond to this moment and to support these causes. Indeed, an oceanic curatorial practice can constitute a useful tool. Curating in an oceanic way is neither limited to nor defined by exhibitions addressing the oceans, but it is composed of methodologies that are hybrid, transdisciplinary, generative, fluid, uncertain, and transformative, working at different temporal and spatial scales and involving various forms of knowledge, both human and non-human. The ocean provides a model to accommodate change and unpredictability, to sway back and forth between, and ultimately to transcend numerous disciplines and invoke performativity both in the exhibition-making process and in the audience experience. In my article, I analyze how exhibitions proceeding from oceanic curating can provide fora to inspire new ways of thinking and feeling. Specifically, I suggest that tidalectics, a term and concept coined by the historian and poet Kamau Brathwaite, who sadly passed away earlier this year while I was working on my text, can provide precious guidance for an oceanic curatorial project. So some of the images I'm showing you here are of an exhibition titled Tidalectics, taking cues from Brathwaite that I curated at TBA 21 Augarten in Vienna in 2017, which traveled onwards to Le Frenois in France, the Museum of Modern Art in Dubrovnik, and the 1483 former monastery on Loughborough. And you can see the list of artists on the slide I'm showing you right now. Tidalectics is a play on words, proposing the tides as an alternative to the dialectics that Brathwaite wrote define much of Western thinking. Whereas socially engaged and interdisciplinary curatorial practices emerged in the 20th century, tidalectic curating, as I have developed a concept and methodology in the past years, is unique in taking its primary inspiration from a natural phenomenon and in performatively engaging with the social and ecological structures of the system in which it operates. Brathwaite introduced tidalectics in his poetry not merely by outlining it, but by performing it. He deploys palimpsests, unusual syncopations, and omitted syllables to invoke the incessant, irregular, generative movement of the waves. He asserts that English, the language of the colonizers in his native Barbados, is not appropriate for the Caribbean colonial and diasporic experience. He writes, and I quote him here, "The hurricane does not roar in pentameters." And yet, Brathwaite's writing elicits how the Caribbean context cannot be unthought from colonialism and its trajectory across the Atlantic, of both colonizers arriving to the islands and slaves who were abducted and exploited on sugarcane plantations. Now, I would like to read you a passage here by Brathwaite. "It takes me back and drags me tidalectic into this tangled, urgent meaning to and fro. Like foam, thoughtless as the bottom, as from the bottom of the sea, dragging our meaning, our moaning song from Calabar along the sea floor with pebble sound and conch and wound and sea sound moon, And you can see in the slide here also the spellings and the punctuation, which I think are particularly important to breath rights writing. So in this passage, the movement of water and bodies towards and from the shore is tangled, and it cannot be thought apart or separated from the middle passage. Breath white evokes a form of being and thinking emerging performatively from his post-colonial context. And I use the word performative in the sense of what the gender studies scholar Eve Kosofsky-Sedgwick calls a strategy for the production of meaning and being relating to affect. In Tidalectics, bodies, water, and meaning are intertwined and move together. When carefully transferred to the curatorial context while acknowledging its specificity and roots within post-colonial Caribbean experience, Tidalectics is particularly productive for approaching climate change as it dissolves ostensible certainties. In breath rights writing, uncertainty does not equate to a frightening realization, undoing a privileged sense of self as climate change often does for the global north, but to a point of departure. Breath rights reminds readers that hybridization is a ubiquitous process promoted by the oceans and that maritime spaces connect rather than divide. Tidalectics, if breathed into curatorial work, helps sustain fluidity as well as encounters between the known and the unknown. The unknown then is not merely integrated into an established framework, but along with the known creates a third space or a hybrid collective and mutual becoming that thinks and makes together with other species and with their surroundings. And I'm inspired by Haraway in this thinking, of course. Tidalectics allows for seeing things in a more holistic, if always partial, situated way. Similarly, ecological issues need to be seen in connection with their wider ramifications and reverberations. Pollution turns water toxic and higher temperatures cause algae to bloom, blocking out sunlight and making whole areas of ocean unlivable for fish, and as a consequence, affecting the livelihoods of humans. Neglect injures and care helps the oceans to thrive. In ecology, as well as in politics, art making, and curatorial practice, more nuanced understandings of these holistic relations are needed. Such nuance does not need to dampen urgency, but it is necessary in order to connect details to a larger, if always tentative, whole. Every wave breaks differently, and with their different forms, each wave affects neighboring waters in a specific way. As Breathwhite points out, human and non-human histories are shaped by these waves and by their specificity. I'm showing you here the cover of a book that I edited, which was published a couple of years back, titled Tidalectics also. Before ending, I would like to introduce two examples for a Tidalectic curatorial methodology. And I'm going on to the next exhibition because I've been showing you, or to the images of the next exhibition because I've been showing you the Tidalectics photographs as I was talking. So in the exhibition Tidalectics in 2017 that I mentioned, I set out to explore a fluid curatorial framework in which not only did each iteration of the traveling exhibition change, but also within each iteration, there was variation to the extent that visitors experienced different shows on different days. In the first version in Vienna, the artist Jana Winderind exhibited her hydrophone recorded sound installation Bara. And the installation was only audible during those times of the day when the tide in Trieste, the closest coast to the exhibition venue, was at the highest and respectively lowest point each day. The fluctuation acted as a way to account for the ever-changing tides and to go beyond the rigidity of temporal and spatial scales that are common in exhibition contexts and also, as Brathwaite would say, in much of the Western world. This curatorial decision necessitated that other works that included sound, such as video installations by Eduardo Navarro and Susanna Winterling, and an immersive sculptural installation, including sound by Emkal Eyongakpa, were turned off to allow listeners to focus on Winderin's audio piece. Similarly, Cecil Tola's smell molecules of different coasts in the Caribbean, in Costa Rica, were distributed in the exhibition during specific times. So the curatorial methodology of the exhibition was Tidalectic because it was not fixed and responded, and it responded to a naturally occurring phenomenon, the tide. It was relational and responsive, or in the words of Haraway, attempting to be responsible. enabling shared and mutually affecting responses to bring about new capacities of agency and ethics. My second example, of which I'm showing you images here, is more direct, responding through action to the holistic perspective that Brathwaite urges us to see. In August this year, I curated the ocean part of the exhibition Down to Earth as part of the Berliner Festspiele Performing Arts Festival at the Gropiusbau. The show took inspiration from the sociologist Bruno Latour's 2017 publication of the same title, Down to Earth, engaging, in Latour's words, the earth with its thousand folds. I brought together works by Miriam Simoon, Simran Gill, Himali Singh Soin, and David Soin Tapaseris, the Sotolas, and others, highlighting different aspects of the ocean from the Black Atlantic to contemporary migration and submarine cables. Concretely, the exhibition worked without any use of electricity. No air conditioning, no artificial light, only daylight, no video works. Travel for the install was reduced as much as possible and mostly occurred only by train. Performers played only unplugged, and many artists reconceived their pieces for the show to adjust them to the circumstances and the consequential ecological requirements. The institution made public its carbon emissions in the accompanying guidebook. And I won't go into further detail here, but I'd be very happy to discuss more in the Q&A. And I also would like to say that in the future, I believe that models such as this remain to be further tested and researched. To conclude, as the Anthropocene unmoors apparent certainties, Western epistemologies based on a separation of knowing and the known are becoming increasingly untenable. The oceans flood not only homes and exhibition spaces, but also dissolve divides between inside and outside, calling for curatorial responses to address this. Such responses are urgently needed, not least because the current moment invokes anxiety and requires new imaginaries. Tidalectics envisions responsible forms of curating that reimagine models of exhibition making originating from the Holocene. Tidalectic curating goes beyond the art field to intersect with other disciplines, be they sociology or marine biology. It takes its cue from natural processes such as the ebb and flow of the tides. It remembers as much as it dissolves incomplete repositories of knowledge, which is a thought by Astrida Neimanis, who was mentioned earlier as well. Tidalectic curating enables processes without knowing where they might lead. It makes room for non-Western practices of knowing to change paradigms and structures. It listens to expertise from ocean users and ocean dwellers, both human and non-human, and their embodied experiences. And I really like the term ocean users, which is coined by Leah Gibbs and Andrew Warren. Tidalectic curating swims with non-humans, both organic and inorganic, and it considers itself as part of the ecotone from which it arises. Tidalectic curating drips and splashes, dives and emerges. It comes with wet feet and leaves with wet hair. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Stefanie. I'm sure there'll be people wanting to ask questions in response to that talk too. So finally, we can now turn over to Miranda Lowe, Principal Curator at the National History Museum. So Miranda, over to you.
Thank you, Mark. Right. Humans can at any point in time, I'm just hoping, can you all see this?
Yeah,
that's fine. Brilliant. Humans at any point in time can be both connected and disconnected from and by the sea. As a natural history curator, humans can at any point in time be both connected and disconnected from and by the sea. As a natural history curator and scientist, I often curate the sea every day, from looking down a microscope to discover the undiscovered finer details.
I think Miranda, you might just need to share the screen again. That's great.
Right. Can you all see this meeting now?
That's great. Perfect.
Fantastic. Sorry, everyone. Apologies. Humans can at any point in time be both connected and disconnected from and by the sea. As a natural history curator and scientist, I curate the sea every day. From looking down a microscope to discover the undiscovered finer details of an animal, to caring for the beautiful Blaschke glass models, such forming representations of creatures of the sea. Glass is both a strength and a fragility in my world. Strong borosilicate glass jars house the fragile jellyfish poised on the wooden shelf tucked inside metal cabinetry within the Natural History Museum in London. The Blaschke model, sculptured by the glass artists' father and son team, Leopold and Rudolf Blaschke, as you can see here, were part of popular museum exhibits worldwide in the mid to late 1800s, connecting the public to the hidden world of the ocean wonders. They are some of the oldest models within the museum's natural science collections. From archival correspondence, I know that the Blaschkes were in contact with and knew the scientists of the time, such as the famous evolutionary biologist Ernest Haeckel, or Haeckel, as some might say, the well-known author of Art Forms in Nature, who lent them books from his library. Often they use major scientific works as a basis for their models. For example, Philip Henry Gosse's Actina Britannica, published in 1860. Although spirit collections cannot reliably preserve some features, we know that they also made observations from real life specimens that they purchased, such as animals, the sea anemones, from a Mr. Smith in Weymouth. Rudolf also visited the northern Italy in 1879, and they had a saltwater aquarium in their studio in Dresden. Earlier in 1853, Leopold was able to observe and sketch jellyfishes when he was marooned in the Azores, and this presumably stimulated his interest in natural history. The models themselves continue to represent the lifelike marine invertebrate forms better than spirit collections of the same taxa, and can be used to teach, for example, the anatomical differences between an octopus, a squid, or the biology of a radiolarian and a jellyfish, as we see representation here on screen. Most recently, American marine biologists have been searching the oceans for the same species of the live animals from the Blaschke model species to see if these animals still exist in the world's oceans today. This kind of comparative scientific work can connect the biodiversity of the ocean in the 1860s to the present day to indicate any environmental changes. This brings the worlds of science and art together. We know that from displayed items that displayed items encouraged other museums to purchase Blaschke items. For example, a trip to the British Museum in 1865 inspired the director of the National Museum of Scotland to purchase a set of anemones for his own museum. We know that many of the major museums in Europe and North America had Blaschka items on display, and these could easily have inspired marine scientists of the time. But these are not the only hidden stories I have told over the last decade. In light of the Black Lives Matter movement of summer 2020, many museums and galleries have moved towards acknowledging colonial histories of their founding collections and the context in which they were acquired. In my 2018 co-authored paper entitled Nature Red in Black and White, Decolonial Approaches to Interpreting Natural History Collections, I examined what it is to have a decolonial approach when working with natural history collections and who is missing, unacknowledged for their contributions to science and was unable to tell their own story. While Charles Darwin, as you can see, a young Charles Darwin in this image here, is best known to the world for being a self-taught zoologist, his oceanographic expedition on HMS Beagle, and for his work in the 1859 book on the origin of species, not much is known about John Edmonston, who you can see on your right, of John Edmonston, a Guyanese man who inspired Darwin to pursue a career in the field of natural history and zoology. Aged 17, Charles Darwin arrived in Edinburgh to study medicine, but little did he know he would come across someone who was to have an impact on his life right up until Darwin's autobiography, for which the text was finally published 5 years after Darwin's death. John Edmonston was indeed the man in question who was to make his mark on the teenage Darwin. Born into slavery in Guyana around 1790, John was owned by Charles Edmonston, who had a woodcutting establishment in Warrow's Place, Maribe Creek in British Guyana. John was later freed by his owner, who had arrived back in Scotland with John, moving to Glasgow, then Edinburgh in 1817. John had learned taxidermy from his owner's Charles Edmondson's son-in-law, Charles Waterton, a naturalist and traveller who from 1816 to 1824 explored the tropical forests of both South and North America and the West Indies. Although Waterton was not initially very complimentary of John's skills as a taxidermist, John went on to successfully earn a living teaching students at the University of Edinburgh on how to do taxidermy, the art of stuffing dead birds. Upon Darwin's arrival in Edinburgh, he lodged with his brother, and John, who was to become Darwin's teacher of taxidermy, lived nearby. Arriving at the university to study medicine, Darwin had a dislike for lectures and dissections, plus lacked confidence in his own drawing ability. However, he had attended the lectures of Dr. Duncan, who John was once a servant to. This is how Darwin most likely became aware of him. And this relationship with John, between Darwin and John, resulted in over 40 hours worth of lessons in taxidermy every day over 2 months. In fact, in January 1826, Darwin wrote to his sister Susan, where he mentioned that he was having taxidermy lessons, cheap at the cost. A lesson cost him 1 guinea for an hour. What more fitting tribute to acknowledge the skilled taxidermist John Edmonston is through the words of John Agard, a poet and children's writer of Guyanese heritage living in Britain, in the 2012 poem, The Ascent of John Edmonston. The poem reminds us that Charles Darwin was taught by a black man who began his life as a slave on a Guyanese plantation, and who most importantly would have encouraged his student Darwin to continue his scientific studies on hearing about the plants and animals of South America, in the hope that one day Darwin would himself visit and gather knowledge and understanding of its natural history and its people. In 1831, at the age of 22, Darwin did indeed aboard the ship HMS Beagle, undertaking a historic voyage of scientific study and natural history. John became one of the very early mentors to Darwin, and with such knowledge transfer, it has helped to inform the Western scientific mainstream thinking, while largely remaining an unrecognized story until now. In Darwin's own autobiography, he calls John a very pleasant and intelligent man. By telling this story, it is giving John a voice that makes sure his narrative is not erased from history, honoring him with the recognition and acknowledgement for his contributions to science. John Edmonston, the man who taught Darwin taxidermy. As you can see, I work within the intersections of art, culture, and science. I'm one of the co-founders of the network called Museum Detox. You've got a picture of some of this here in front of a large coral specimen at the museum. This organization, with protests, activism, and interest, is a network of members that strive for inclusive cultural rights and cultural democracy. Before I finish, I'd just like to leave you with a few words from the recently published Museums Association Learning and Engagement Manifesto. Access to and participation in culture is a basic human right. Everyone has a right to representation and agency in museums and galleries, and communities should have the power to decide how they engage and contribute to culture, to the wider good of society. The most significant function of museums, galleries, libraries, and archives and universities are as centers for cultural democracy, where children, young people, and adults learn through practical experience that we all have cultural rights. Having the opportunity to create and to give to others may be one of our greatest sources of fulfillment. Culture is everywhere and is created by everyone. Thank you for listening.
Thanks very much indeed, Miranda. And thanks for that final discussion too. Right, I think what we're going to do now, everyone, is that we're going to briefly welcome the editors of the Journal of Curatorial Studies, Dr. Jennifer Fisher and Dr. Jim Drobnik, who I think will say a few words about this special issue before we then turn to the discussion that will follow those papers. So if I can, I think we can hopefully find Jim and Jennifer. And if you can unmute yourselves or be unmuted, maybe you can speak to the collective, Jim and Jennifer, if you're there.
If it's possible, could Jennifer and Jim please virtually raise their hands?
So Jennifer, I think you can speak now and we should be able to hear you. If you unmute yourself.
There, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can't see you. If you can show yourself too, it would be great if you can show your face.
How do I show my face?
I don't think that's an option, I'm afraid.
Yeah, it's not like we're on Zoom.
Carry on.
Yeah, well, hello. Hello, Pandora. Hello, Sarah. It's so lovely to see you this morning. It's a very early morning here in Toronto for us. And lovely to see Stefanie and Miranda's presentation and to see you, Mark. Just briefly, we just wanted to thank you so much for your incredible efforts to create such a beautiful issue. And it's a really important topic. Of the sea and of the epistemological models that you've drawn from it and applied so beautifully in your essays. And it was a great experience and we're really pleased and proud with the issue. So congratulations to you. And without further ado, I think we're just going to continue. Jim had to step out for a minute. So I think we'll just maybe continue with your questions. I don't want to hold you up.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks so much, Jennifer. And yeah, I can imagine that you're very, very excited by this issue. Just from what we've been hearing, it's clearly such a rich area of contemporary curatorial thinking and debate. And what I'd like to do is to urge everyone to either write their questions in the Q&A box, if you'd like questions to ask to any of our speakers. So please go ahead and do that if you'd like to write a question. Otherwise, if you nominate yourselves to as it were, raise a hand, we'll be able to call upon you to and unmute you so you can ask your questions verbally. So if you'd like to raise a hand, we should then be able to unmute you and you'll be able to ask a question to any of our speakers. I guess, if I can take Chair's prerogative here, maybe Stefanie, just to get back to you first of all, I'd love to ask about the kind of aesthetics of this kind of Tidalectic curations and exhibitions that you've been participating in and shaping yourself, about the role of what, as an aesthetic experience, the kind of exhibitions you've been creating, curating, and been looking at. What's the interplay between aesthetics and the Tidalectic to your eyes?
Thank you, that's a great question. I've been quite interested in sensing and sense making through other than only the visual, particularly because of the history of vision also in Western colonialism. Actually in the book that I didn't mention, but Prospecting Ocean, it's a book I wrote, which was published last year, I make a larger argument for other forms of knowing or other forms of being that are more embodied, coming also from a feminist perspective and questioning basically the paradigm of vision, which was shaped by inventions such as the telescope, the microscope, in fact, too, in the way that the Western subject or scientist would see themselves as outside of the paradigms they were studying. So how do we consider ourselves as immersed and a part of the nature cultures we study? So in exhibitions that very often plays out by including other forms of art that are not only visual, such as, for example, smell that I mentioned very briefly. Mm-hmm. And I actually had to think about something that Miranda was saying too, with how people were looking at blush gun models to go back and see whether certain species still exist. And actually, this is what I find particularly interesting, how art can be both an aesthetic experience and also give us access to forms of knowing or, archiving. So in the case of Sissel Tolles' smells, for instance, they allow you to engage on a sensory level. Smell is important to me because it connects to the parts in the brain where memory is processed and emotions are activated. But it also allows you to analyze the molecules that Sissel collects and then to go back and see whether and how the composition of molecules has changed over several years. So it is both a visceral experience and an archive that allows you to revisit ecologies in the future.
Thank you. I think we have some people who want to ask their questions verbally. So Alberta, is that, I think you can have a chance to ask a question, is that right? Well, I don't know whether, or Alicia, we have also Alicia Weisberg-Roberts. Is that, are you able to ask a question verbally?
Sorry. I would like to come in and ask a question if possible while there's a moment. And I was hoping to ask Stefanie, it's Anna Reed talking, by the way. I was hoping to ask Stefanie, I was really interested to hear you talk about the idea that we need more nuanced understandings. When you talked about the way that nuanced understandings are needed and that there is that's not to negate urgency. And I wondered whether you thought that urgency and the kind of ethos of urgency has actually in some sense gotten the way of the nuance that's required and the kind of strategies that are required for transformation of curatorial processes.
Thank you, Anna. Yeah, you know, I think there need to be different layers involved. So I think Anat Singh's writing on different scales, for instance, and how we approach the Anthropocene and can see connections between different elements is particularly productive in this sense, because I believe that, you know, strategic essentialism, in the words of Spivak, can be incredibly important and powerful, but it depends on where it is applied. And I believe that this is not to say that, you know, political movements are incredibly important and that they need to speak with as much force and power as they possibly can, but to understand the different relations, for example, the intersections of domination that are at play in the ocean and its colonial history and presence, right? So which has to do with ecology, but also environmental and racial and social justice, right? So I think that this is important also for exhibition making. And what I am interested in Tidalectics is how can we get away from making large, grand kind of statements or arguments without losing the urgency or without losing the capacity to communicate, basically. And I guess a counter model to Tidalectics would be Frederick Jameson's cognitive mapping, which I always thought was incredibly fascinating, you know, and also early cybernetic sort of experiments like the Chilean cybersyn system that tried to model the country's economy and try to predict everything that happens. If you introduce one change in the system, like you raise the taxes, for example, lower them, what happens? But, you know, all of these models are clearly not adequate for explaining entirely complex ecological systems, which I also consider social systems to be a part. So how to be fluid and adaptive and I guess Tidalectic, but without giving up the possibility to make claims, especially political, very needed claims.
Thank you, Stefan. I wonder if that's a question that both Sarah and Pandora might also want to respond to, and Miranda too, just thinking about, again, that the relationship between urgency and nuance in a place like the Natural History Museum or in the different exhibitions that Sarah and Pandora, you both know about so well.
I sort of go first, really, because I was just thinking about Miranda's talk last week at the National Science Collections Association conference, and talking about how these sort of practices need time. And when you're talking about sort of decolonizing projects, there were some questions that came up then about how you can do it sort of quickly and how you can do it without budget. And it's a case of making a start somewhere and needing to have time to think things through properly, I think, is what you were alluding to, Miranda, in your answers. So I don't know if you agree that there's a kind of, you know, things need time to happen.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with you, Sarah, and that was the point that I was making, because in terms of curators within museums, we're often, you know, against, but time is against us, and the other roles that we have in documenting the artifacts and specimens that we have. But I feel personally for any kind of decolonial curatorial practice to be meaningful and to embed itself properly as a process within the exhibition process, other types of curatorial practice, it will take time, and we do need to allow ourselves time to do that work, and not to, as a curator myself, not to do it in isolation. It's like working with artists and many other people to give a holistic perspective on that practice.
I've got a question that I'd like to put to the panelists from Faith Weddell, who's written in the Q&A box. And the question is, do the panelists find that contemporary methods of display are perhaps more compelling in creating a sense of compassion and care in the audience than, say, older modes like the cabinet curiosity?
I feel like I should maybe answer this, since my essay and the special issue is about that very topic. So I think it's really interesting to think through the Cabinet of Curiosities, which, as you recognise, is a historical mode of display, but also one that has seen a resurgence in contemporary art and curatorial practice. which is sometimes not always deployed in the most critical way that perhaps it should be, given the colonial histories it's tied to and the exploitation that's involved in sort of the collecting practices that inform that. But I think what I argue in my essay is for returning to this kind of mode of display. You open the possibility for creating new narratives and developing different sorts of knowledge by these non-linear, non-hierarchical display models that place the kind of onus, if you like, on the museum visitor or the viewer of the artwork to make their own relationships and have this kind of relational encounter with what it is unfolding in front of them. So I think I sort of lost the track of your actual question there, but you sort of make a differentiation between historical and contemporary modes of display that I think are actually quite entangled in really interesting and complicated ways. So I don't know whether anyone else wants to come in on that point.
I just want to add something to that, which I mean, from my perspective, and I think this comes through in your article, Sarah, there's also varying levels of sort of historical awareness that different exhibitions and museums mobilize these more historical modes of display. So I think the main example you're looking at with Mark Dion's Oceanomania is obviously very sort of self-reflective of the museum's own collection and history. Whereas I think in other instances, in a number of natural history museums, for example, that is necessarily looking at the sort of historical problematics that underlie those histories. But it connects to something I was thinking about Miranda's talk, which is really interesting, was this idea about John Edmonston's influence on Darwin's thought. I think Miranda said influence on this sort of accepted hegemonic Western epistemology, showing how much that, so-called Western epistemology is not only going against these alternative knowledge systems, but also often appropriating, so that it becomes a very sort of an entangled, non-linear, sort of epistemological soup that's coming through in these institutions and their histories.
There's a question that I have that's again in the Q&A box. And again, for anyone watching and listening and thinking of questions, please submit your questions into the Q&A box, then I can pass them on to the panelists. And this is from Natalie Kiefer, and it's from all of the panelists. And the question is this: the important collaboration of art and science was mentioned several times in the talks. Scientific exploration of the ocean has, however, often led to the exploitation of the ocean. How can further exploration not lead to more exploitation? Is there sensitivity to this within the curatorial practices you discuss and are part of?
I'll just say a bit about this. It can lead to less exploitation. So within museums, there is still a lot of material to be discovered, unopened from the time of collection. So, but it's not seen as glamorous as yet to get. It's always a lot more exciting and fundable if you're going to explore and find something new than to look at the backlog of collections, unidentified specimens that are potentially new for science. I mean, there've been papers written on this that it could, on average, it takes over 100 years or 150 years to discover something new that's actually sitting in an unopened jar in the collection, new species to science. So that's one way we can have less exploitation on the world's oceans. For instance, I have part of all of the collections I look after, 27,000 jars, so lots of jars, unopened since the time of collection from, these are not the 1800s, but from 1927 to the 1950s. And so I spend a lot of my time being an advocate for those historical collections to be used to inform, you know, conservation policy currently, and as increasingly, you know, certain parts of the world's oceans become, you know, of scientific importance and no-take zones. So that's how there could be less exploitation to actually look and exploit what we have within the museum.
And the other panelists responding to that question, Stefanie?
Yeah, I think, you know, I've worked quite a bit with artists on commissions where we collaborate with people from other disciplines, be that scientists or, you know, other disciplines. But I think it is a question that we're very aware of when working with artists. And usually the scientists who are willing to collaborate are also very aware of that. So, you know, it's, but I do think that through these cross-disciplinary conversations, one can find new perspectives and also contribute to communicating issues of urgency.
And Sarah, Pandora, did you want to talk at all about this issue, about this relationship between scientific exploration and exploitation?
I mean, I guess just the question of exploitation, as we were discussing, is not only of these sort of natural non-human resources, but it also affects different ocean living communities or non-ocean living communities as well. And, you know, as we all know, unequally. And I mean, I think this comes down to much larger questions about what I mean, I can't speak directly to scientific exploration, but within exhibitions and institutions, is it about creating awareness? Is it about, you know, creating reflection? And I have, I sort of have a few questions off the back of this, actually, which is, I think Stefanie mentioned culture declares emergency, which is this initiative bringing artists, people working in the cultural sector, different institutions together to declare an ecological emergency. And I guess I'm just wondering about this type of activist work. Sorry, I'm sort of going in a very different direction now, but I just want to ask about how much, maybe Stefanie, you might be able to speak to this, how much you think this type of action is sort of drawing on some of the Tidalectic methods, or is its for its theme, or is it responding to I don't know, sorry, I've sort of lost my train of thought, but I'm just thinking about more specifically activist realms, because we've been looking at exhibitions within institutions, but I don't know if you want to speak a bit about this type of cultural activism.
Yeah, I think we see more and more of that. I think it is also not, you know, not everybody's medium or form of communicating. I mean, there's many artists who work beautifully through poetry and through other forms of work that can be very political and also can feed into direct activism without being that itself necessarily. But I do think that there's more awareness of the art world and our own contribution to these issues. And, you know, that's what I was talking about a bit earlier too, when I was speaking about, you know, whether we think of ourselves as outside of the system that we're analyzing or criticizing, or if we're actually a part of it. And so I think that more awareness of our very own, you know, footprint, for instance, or also the way that, you know, as with anything, as soon as you make it visible, it can also be exploited. Like, I think it's all very specific and requires consideration regarding each context and situation. But I do think that it's very exciting that it is more accepted and, you know, becoming more mainstream to consider ecology in institutions and to consider activism as part of the tools of an institution.
I have a question from an anonymous attendee here, and this is a very interesting question, almost the mirror image of that engagement activism that you've just been talking about, Stefanie and Pandora. This is the question: how do you navigate interactions with curators or museum audiences who are uninterested or apathetic to issues such as historical exploitation and colonialism as they relate to museum objects? That's the question that I've been sent in, or that we've been sent in. Interesting to get your responses to that.
Can I just refer back to our In Conversation piece that we did with Miranda and Richard, because I'm just thinking about what you said about the coral exhibition, Miranda, and how it ends with the aquarium in a way to kind of lift the mood. And I think what that coral exhibition, I don't know if anyone in the audience went to it, but I mean, it was a really, really beautifully designed exhibition, and it was kind of aesthetically really engaging and really wonderful to wander around. So I guess there's that sort of visual level that people can relate to these things with. And I think, I mean, Miranda, you probably want to speak to this more than me, but a lot of the corals were sort of, you know, beige, they didn't have any colour. And so the exhibition was enlivened by the live corals at the end to sort of lift the mood, but also add a more colourful dimension into these kinds of things, which I think is interesting to think about. You know, given that when people engage with things, maybe they want to find out more about them, and that can maybe introduce people to the ecological issues that are sort of surrounding these displays or whatever.
Yeah, no, I entirely agree with what you say, Sarah. That was a talking point continuously throughout the exhibition when we were selecting the corals to display, because every one, you know, they're dead animals, you know, that's the skeleton that you're seeing essentially. But from another perspective, there is beauty in those structures of those dead pieces of coral. But that's why we wanted the, as you've mentioned, the aquarium at the end, because also for people to connect and to make that association, because a dead coral and a live coral can look completely different in terms of obviously the colours, that are portrayed deep within the ocean on a coral reef to when it dies off and it's bleached, to have that connection and the uplift at the end. And then there was a video, I think, was it the island of Bermuda at the end of what, so in terms of hope with the coral reefs and what is happening in those communities that surrounded by the ocean and how they live on the ocean and study it as well, and creating that awareness on those particular islands of those issues too around them.
Any other responses to that question about how you engage with audiences and even curators who don't are not sympathetic to your, I guess, or not interested, especially in what might seem a particular perspective?
It's a very good question, and I think one of the most difficult questions, especially in the arts world. I feel we're very often considering that, you know, people are mostly, you know, aware of these issues and why they're important. But yeah, I think it's mainly about insistence and, you know, doing the work regardless. Because I think the presence is important, and for the work to also enter history and history writing, for it to not be as easily erased.
I have another question. Sorry, Pandora.
Just to quickly say, I mean, I think to me the question, because I don't think many institutions especially are going to, proclaim that they're uninterested in, ecological disaster histories of colonial exploitation. But I think the question, and I don't have the answer for this, is how do you get institutions to commit to ongoing action? Because I think a lot of exhibitions, there have been a number of sort of blockbuster ecological exhibitions. It's a new phenomenon. And institutions will deploy these sort of sustainable methods of curation and exhibition design for that exhibition, but you know, are they going to commit to these measures in an ongoing fashion, or is it sort of lip service to the cause, sort of like Morgan Quaintance's criticism of the Tate turbine Kara Walker installation, you know, sort of meant to tick a box. And yeah, I mean, to me, that's the real question that needs to be considered.
But it comes back to this idea that all of these things have to be really embedded in what institutions are doing, you know, all of these sort of discussion points that we're rehearsing throughout this panel are obviously really, really significant, but it needs to be embedded in all of the practices and processes behind museum work as well, like you say, on a more ongoing way, whereas exhibitions are sort of transient. I guess the institutional structure and the organisational structure and the kind of practicalities of putting exhibitions on in sustainable ways needs to be embedded, I guess, deeply in the institution.
I've got a final question maybe, and it might be the last because of time is running out, about a question from Bronwyn Bailey Charteris, who's asking about, she'd said, thanks for the great presentations, and that she's working with watery thinking in curatorial practice. She'd like you to say more about why the ocean and the sea in particular was the focus of this publication and your own research. And she was asking about how you think about other kinds of watery states, such as mist or puddles were her examples, and the curatorial. So that's the question from Bronwyn Bailey Charteris. I don't know if anyone would like to respond to that one.
I can begin to respond to that just by saying that the project started really as a response to just this proliferation of ocean-themed exhibitions, and these were increasingly becoming more explicitly ecological. And I mean, Sarah and I showed a bunch of different examples, but we could have shown dozens more, really. It's really been a real phenomenon over the past several years, or definitely within the past decade. But I think the sort of more watery thinking has really been coming through in a lot of cultural theory during this time. Sarah, do you want to say anything?
I guess, you know, when you're talking about watery thinking, there's projects on rivers as well that I've sort of seen come up. So sort of different bodies of water, to refer to Estudio Mars's book again, quite literally have been the sort of origins of thinking about exhibitions in ways. I mean, I guess water is sort of fascinating to people because it's something that sort of divides and connects. And these issues are things that are kind of coming up time and time again in the discussions that we're having and the exhibitions that we're talking about as well. So I guess there is something about water that sort of attracts people. But as Pandora said, it was the sea specifically that we were drawn to, simply because of this, what we recognised as a sort of trend or pattern in exhibition making more than anything else.
And just to add, I think that did correspond to a larger discourse around ecology and the sort of move from, you know, charismatic land animals in untouched nature, that sort of image of ecology, you know, the WWF panda bear, you know, moving to the stranded polar bear on the iceberg, and then more recently looking at more diverse life forms and their interactions with humans and human activity.
Great. Well, look, I'm just looking at the clock and I realize that we're coming to the end of our session now. So we've had a fantastic turnout. More than 100 people have signed in to watch proceedings and to engage in this panel, and they've been rewarded by a really, really, not only a great set of papers, but a really interesting discussion. So thanks to Stefanie, to Miranda, to Sarah, and to Pandora. Thanks to Jim and Jennifer for editing such a great journal, and it sounds like one that really will be read and pondered over for in very serious ways over the months to come, because it's clearly touching upon a really crucial issue of our time. So thanks very much, and I'd just like to urge everyone to keep on attending our events and to become part and to remain part of the British Art and Natural Forces programme. But again, thanks very much to all our speakers for a really great panel. And I hope that felt like a properly celebratory and thoughtful way to launch what is clearly a special issue of this journal. Thank you all very much indeed.